let's talk about the movements of synovial joints. In our next unit, when we talk about the muscular system, understanding these joint movements will become very important. When we talk about an action of a muscle, we are going to need to understand these movements. For example, the biceps brachii muscle, which is the muscle of your arm on the anterior of your arm, when it contracts, it causes elbow flexion. Elbow flexion is the action. So understanding these movements not only will help you in this unit, but also in our next unit. Now, almost all of these movements or actions come in twos: flexion, extension, abduction, adduction, opposition, reposition. Only two do not come in twos. But let's talk about each of these movements and describe them, as well as visualize them on a model, of course, from standard anatomical position. So it's important to understand that these movements or actions take place relative to standard anatomical position. Let's start with flexion and extension. Flexion and extension is the movement in the sagittal plane that either increases or decreases the distance or the angle between the two bones that are articulating. So for example, a biceps curl, that exercise you might do in the gym, is elbow flexion. You're bringing your forearm closer to your arm, and that's called elbow flexion. Now, if you were going to return to standard anatomical position, that movement is called extension. So flexion brings the weight towards your arm, and extension brings it back to standard anatomical position. If we were going to flex the knee in the gym, you might do something like a hamstring curl, where you lie on one of those benches and you put the weight behind your ankle and then you bring that weight towards your buttocks. That is knee flexion. When you bring that weight back to neutral or returning your body to standard anatomical position, that would be called extension or knee extension. You can do hip flexion and hip extension. You can do shoulder flexion and shoulder extension. Of course, elbow flexion, elbow extension. You can do wrist flexion and wrist extension. You can even do head flexion. So that would be bringing your chin towards your manubrium, or head extension. And that would be bringing your head away from your manubrium towards the back of your body. The term hyperextension simply means to extend beyond standard anatomical position. So hyperextending the knee could occur when you're going to kick a soccer ball and the soccer ball is not there and you kick your leg out and then your knee kind of straightens very, very quickly and it might hurt. That's because you are hyperextending your knee. In the picture, the head is hyperextending when you bring it beyond standard anatomical position and even closer towards the back of your body. So these are flexion and extension movements. They occur in the sagittal plane, and it decreases or increases the angle between two bones. Abduction and adduction occur in the frontal plane. So side to side. Starting in standard anatomical position, abduction is when you move a limb away from the midline of the body. So if you were going to do a jumping jack, that first jumping part where you bring your arms away from your body up over your head, that would be shoulder abduction. And if you're also adding in hip abduction, that occurs as well in a jumping jack. So abduction moves the body part or moves the bone away from the midline. Now, adduction is movement of that body part or limb back to standard anatomical position. So the first half of a jumping jack would be abduction of the shoulder and abduction of the hip. Going back to neutral would be adduction of the shoulder and adduction of the hip. You can also do wrist abduction and adduction, so moving your wrist just to the side away from the midline, bringing it back to standard anatomical position would be adduction. So abduction and adduction occur in the frontal plane, so side to side, and it allows you to bring the bone or a limb away from the midline and back towards the midline. Circumduction is one of the actions that doesn't come in a pair. It's simply circumduction. It's this conical movement that occurs most of the time around a ball and socket joint. So it's that big round shoulder movement you can do when you want to maybe bring your arms in towards the midline and then back out towards the midline. You can also do the same thing with the hip joint. It's also a ball and socket joint. You can also move your neck. So if you're to roll your neck in a big circle towards the left or towards the right, that might be head circumduction. So it's this big conical movement, normally of a ball and socket joint, and we call it circumduction. Rotation is another one of the terms that doesn't come in a pair. It's simply rotation. Now, rotation is the turning of a bone around its long axis or around a fixed point. So you can do shoulder rotation where you just simply roll your arm towards the middle. We might call that medial rotation. If you just simply roll your shoulder externally, we would call that lateral rotation. There's a group of muscles of the shoulder called the rotator cuff muscles. There are four of them that are involved with rotation of the shoulder. In fact, athletes, pitchers, baseball pitchers, swimmers, tennis players, athletes that do a movement that involves a lot of that shoulder rotation really need to pay attention to their rotator cuff muscles to keep them strong, to prevent injury. But it's that rotation movement that we're talking about. So medial rotation and lateral rotation. Shaking your head no is also rotation. When we learned about the cervical vertebrae, we saw that C1 sits on top of C2. C2 has this nice little lifted portion, a process called the dens. And it's around the dens of C2 that C1 rotates. Specifically, it's a pivot joint, but the movement is called rotation. So shaking your head no is either right rotation, if you're going to go to the right, and left rotation. And that's specifically the joint between C1 and C2 of the cervical vertebrae. So rotation is a unique movement. It normally occurs like circumduction around a ball and socket joint, but it can also occur around C1 and C2. Special movements of the jaw are elevation and depression. So to chew, we do elevation and depression. So to bring your jaw down, to open your mouth, that would be depression. And then to return your jaw back to standard anatomical position, your mouth would be closed, that would be elevation. You can also stick your chin out or your jaw out towards the anterior. That would be called protraction. And then returning your jaw back to standard anatomical position would be called retraction. And then moving your jaw side to side would be called lateral excursion. So you could do right lateral excursion or left lateral excursion. Special movements of the foot are inversion and eversion. Inversion would be like walking pigeon-toed. Maybe your toes are pointing towards one another, or just moving your ankle in that movement, in that action. And then eversion would be bringing it back to standard anatomical position. So that movement back from inverted back to standard anatomical position. That would be eversion. Dorsiflexion and plantar flexion are two movements of the foot or the ankle. Dorsiflexion would be like flexing your foot, so bringing your toes towards your body. Plantar flexion would be pointing your toes away from your body. Special movements of the forearm are supination and pronation. Pronation would be when you're in standard anatomical position to roll your forearm so that your palms face posteriorly. And then bringing your palms back to standard anatomical position would be supination. Our last special movement involves the thumb. Bringing your thumb towards the middle of your hand and joining it or touching it to your pinky finger is called opposition. Only the thumb does opposition. And then bringing your thumb and pinky back to standard anatomical position is called reposition. So all of these movements occur at different joints of the body. Flexion and extension occur in many places. Abduction and adduction also occur in many places. The special movements of the jaw, like elevation, depression, protraction, retraction, special movements of the foot, special movements of the forearm and thumb, all of these enable your body to move and alter from standard anatomical position.